It is the greatest thing you can ever do, is to honor the Savior of men. The only way to heaven is Jesus Christ. There is no other way. Thank God you and I have found that way. And if you've never gotten to know Jesus, then tonight I'm going to give you an invitation to know him, so that you too can know the one who created it all, the one who died on a cross for you. 2,000 years ago, he paid for every sin you ever committed. And he'd like to give you his peace. Tonight, I want to speak about the power of truth that is believed. Truth that is believed has got incredible power. Power to heal human bodies. Power to drive out demon spirits. Power to change a human life. Power to take you into eternity. Truth believed is incredible. To my knowledge, the Bible never tells you to believe with your head. It tells you to believe with your heart, or your inward person, or the hidden person of the heart. Peter calls your spirit, 1 Peter 3:4. The inward man, the outward man, 2 Corinthians 4:16. Paul speaks about it. Your inward person, the you on the inside, is your spirit. You will live forever. You cannot die. You are a spirit being. You are essentially a spirit. You can kill a human body, but you cannot kill a spirit. And your spirit will return to the God who gave it. He formed you in your mother's womb. And he breathed onto you as that little tiny, tiny seed in the mother's womb, and gave you a spirit. We are made in the image of God. God is spirit. John 4:24. But you have to believe. Your heart can believe. In fact, I know this. God said to me once, 40-odd years ago, and I've believed it ever since. He said, your spirit can do in the realm of the spirit everything that your natural person can do in the natural world. And it is so true. Well, we're talking about believing truth. When Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water, and then he noticed the waves boisterous and he beginning to sink, he cried out and said, "Lord, save me." Jesus had this to say. He said, "Peter, why did you doubt?" The doubt let him sink. The doubt will let the healing fly past you. Doubt will leave the demon in you. Doubt will leave the troubled atmosphere around you. Doubt is the most expensive commodity on this planet Earth. There is nothing as expensive as doubt. It'll rob you of the presence of God. It'll make you say, "Was that really God?" Doubt will form questions in you. Doubt has never helped anybody, unless you've got a con artist trying to sell you an island in the middle of the ocean or something. Then you want to doubt him, but that's a con artist. You do not doubt the word of God, for it's the truth. Or when the disciples were trying to cast a demon out of a boy, and they couldn't do it. And then Jesus came by and he cast the demon out, no problem. The disciples came to Jesus and said, "Why couldn't we cast him out?" And Jesus said, "Because of your unbelief." But those disciples believed that Jesus could cast out demons. They saw it every day. They believed in miracles. They saw them every day. There was nothing wrong with their head belief. But their heart couldn't believe that they could deliver that boy. And so they couldn't do it. The disciples were occupied with a demon in the boy. Jesus was occupied with the unbelief in the hearts of the disciples. I wonder what he's occupied with you. Is there unbelief lurking inside of you? It'll cost you. It'll cost you everything. You can't afford it. Get rid of it. Unbelief is a curse. It'll destroy you. It's not head belief, it's heart belief. It's the inner life that you have purposed and trained to believe. Belief is not an accident. It's not something that falls from the sky over you. It's a decision you make. That I, in my inner man, or if you're a lady in your inner woman, will believe. I'll believe till hell freezes over, then I'll walk across. I just will believe. If the opposition seems great, I believe. If it seems like it's hopeless, I believe. If I pray for somebody and they don't get healed, I believe and I'll pray again. And I'll keep it up. I believe. I am a believer. I am not a doubter. I believe. I believe that God is going to move in this nation of Australia. I believe it with every fiber of my being. I believe he'll turn this nation around. I believe it. I believe it. And should I die not seeing it happen, my believing will not go to waste, because it'll fall on somebody in the next generation, and they will rise up and they'll do things through the belief of the generation that went before. Our believing never goes to waste. It's in the atmosphere, and God will drop it on somebody. And they'll rise up and they'll say, man, I'm just doing great. And they don't realize that somebody broke through. And my God, that faith level can fall on you. Why would you let your inner man or woman live with doubt? It is a curse. Truth believed is what transforms you. Truth doubted doesn't do anything. The outer man is governed by the mind and the human emotion. The inner man is governed by what it believes or what it doubts. That's you and me in a nutshell. We fall into one of those categories. We are told to believe with our heart, Romans 10:10. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. The church has reduced that great word salvation to getting saved. But that word salvation, soterio, means to be made whole. Getting saved or coming to Jesus is the beginning of that journey into wholeness. But the full salvation is wholeness. Wholeness, body, soul, and spirit. So with the mouth, confession is made. Agreement with God is made to wholeness. To wholeness. What do you say? It is very important what you say. What do you make agreement with? For death and life is in the power of your tongue, and you will eat the fruit of your tongue. God said so. So God created me to put a little member in my mouth that could determine my destiny, for it will agree with something. You will agree with the problem, the impossibility, or you will agree with God's word. The choice is yours. It's your choice. Oh, there'll be a generation that'll rise up and agree that the Spirit of God will fall on this country and on the people of Australia. My God, that the Holy Ghost will come down in glorious power. Pentecost needs the Penti again. Or Pentecostals. They've got the costal, they need the Penti. That is the power. The Holy Ghost is the one. So what do you believe? I'm sure we all believe the Bible's the word of God, so does the devil. What do you believe? What does your heart believe? Who are you? I'll tell you what believing does. Makes you strong on the inside. It gives you a spirit made of iron. You won't be pushed over. Not if you believe with your spirit, your inward man, woman. No. You'll be still standing after the fire's been and gone. The fire of the belief in a human heart will change history. It'll certainly change you, your family. Nothing can stand against sheer belief. You have a belief inside of you. Well, you have the capacity to believe. You can turn the switch on or off. But you're the one who'll do it. For it's your spirit. It's your faith. But with the heart, man believes unto, that's a principle, unto health, unto blessing, unto salvation for your family, unto a way where there is no way. The Bible says with the heart, man believes unto righteousness. But the principle is the heart, the spirit, the inward man believes unto whatever it is you're believing unto for. Anything. There's believing for nations. Good on you. So you'll have them. Whatever you believe for, you'll get it. Will it get it instantly? Most likely not. Will there be some problems? Yes. Well, at least I've usually found so. The Apostle Paul found a few. Jesus found a couple too. So the person who says, well, if it's God, there won't be a problem, they haven't read the Bible. Moses had a couple. He hit the Red Sea. It looked impossible. Totally impossible. But he had a stick in his hand. God said, lift up the stick. Well, what a useless thing that is. To lift up the stick. But when he lifted up that stick, which was impregnated with the power of God, those waters parted. And 3 million people walked across on dry land. And if you type in where they crossed the Red Sea into Mr. Google, he knows everything. He'll tell you that the chariot wheels are still there. And he'll tell you that Solomon erected a pillar right where they crossed. And it's written in their ancient language on that pillar, this is where they crossed. Oh yeah, the Bible is a wonderful book. It's the greatest book on earth. It teaches you the way to heaven. And at any price, you want to get that book into your heart and there into your believing system. That's where it's got power. When you believe it, it has power. If you don't believe it, you leave it on the shelf. It's a book. But you touch that thing with your human faith, and it's a marvelous, marvelous thing. In Mark 11, 23 and 24, it says, whatsoever things you desire, things, T-H-I-N-G-S, things you desire, natural things, spiritual things, when you pray, believe you receive them. In other words, I take them from the realm of the Spirit, where 1 Corinthians 3, I think it's verse 21, says, all things are yours. When I reach into that realm of God where all things are mine and I bring it from that realm to this realm over my life, not once, not twice, but for the rest of your life, you bring it down over your life and my God, he'll do anything, for it's all there. But for believers, you believe whatsoever things you desire when you pray. Believe you receive them and you shall have them. The Son of God said that. It won't ever fail. Your believing might, but he won't. In that realm of the Spirit which is all over us, it's not far away. Heaven is not a long way off. It's all here. It's round about us. In him we live and move and have our being. That the Spirit of God is in us and round about us. And my God, all that you need for this life's journey, God has placed in your bank account. And you draw it by believing and receiving over your life, into your life, over and over and over and over again. not by repetition that is just repetition, but by believing and receiving. And you shall have it. 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 Jesus said so. He can't lie. God is not a man that he should lie, neither the Son of Man that he should repent. When Jesus said in John 8:31 to 32, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Unless you understand the Bible, you'll say, well, I'll memorize the truth. But memorized truth is a very good thing. But it won't set you free. Believe truth sets you free. Now, to memorize it, absolutely. You should try and memorize something of it every day of your life. Memorize truth. But memorized truth alone just leaves truth in your head. You've got to get truth to come down inside of you. And all this marvelous truth represents, say it's freedom that you're looking for from a troubled mind or something. Then my faith reaches into heaven where I've got a whole mind. And I bring that whole mind down over my mind that was troubled. And I drive out all this junk and I do it again. And I thank God for it. I praise God for it. I rejoice in it. I thank Him with all of my being, and that mighty mind, for He's made us new. Everything you need is in your bank account in the Spirit. And you make withdrawals by believing and receiving. Oh, there's nothing like truth. Thank God for that book. It's the book of life. At any price, give me the book of life. Let it get into my soul and into my spirit, so the truth is my bulwark, my strength, is my everything. Absolutely. We've all got to differentiate between the inward and outward man. If you don't, you'll just live in an odd situation. You are you on the inside, and you do have an outside person. Why did God make us like that? Because we're the only creatures that He ever created who has a spirit. You are an outward person to relate to this outward world. I have a mind so I can think for this outward world. But I am a spirit being, essentially. And with my spirit, I can know God who is spirit. And God, the mighty God, this world isn't the mighty place. This world was created by a spirit. God, our Heavenly Father, you as an individual were created by a spirit. Now I know your mum and dad had a bit to do with it. But it was God who put a spirit inside of you. In your mother's womb. He said, I formed you in your mother's womb. So, Jody, you were formed in there. How about that? You wouldn't fit now. But you were formed in the hidden place, in the secret place. Oh, how great is God that God would form you in your mother's womb and breathe His spirit into you. So when you were born, you were a spirit. You can't kill a baby. You can kill its body, but you can't kill a baby. The baby's got a spirit, lives forever. Whether it's taken a breath or not, it lives forever. That's why abortion's such a horrible thing. It's anyhow, God breathe on that child. If you have a stillborn baby in your history, one day you'll meet it in heaven. For it never sinned. It'll be there. Grown up, most likely. Will you know it? Absolutely. Of course, because there are all things are known. Will it know you? Oh, yes. Well, it's not an it, it's a him or her. There's no transgender in the heavens. Anyhow, I've got to get out of that. If you're just got a mind, if you're just a mind which our Western world promotes the human mind. And thank God for our mind. My Lord, I am not putting down our mind. Educate it. Make it great. Thank God for scientists who've discovered air-conditioned cars. Thank God for it. Who'd want to go back to winding your windows down, putting your elbow out? How many of you remember those days? You're showing your age now. Truth is eternal. It'll never change. Jesus Christ will be the Savior in 1,000 years' time, should Jesus tarry. He'll still be the Savior. He'll still be God. You and I'll be in heaven or the other place. But don't go there. It's not nice. You're terrible company. Satan, demons, murderers, rapists, jihadists. Who would want to live with them? Forever and ever and ever and ever. World without end. If you think it's hard being a Christian, have a look at the alternative. It's easy being a Christian. It's easy. The alternative's no good. Come to Christ. So, but the question is, how do I get truth down on the inside of me? How do I take it from here and put it to here? And I realize I must have used up most of my time, so I'll endeavor to be brief. In Joshua 1:8, it says this, "This book of the law, or this book of the ways of God, this book of the truths of God, shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate therein day and night." I would suggest there's not much time left. "That you may observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then you shall make your way prosperous, and then you shall have good success." He was saying this to Joshua, who was going to conquer with a few million or 400,000 in the army, ex-slaves who'd never fought a battle except against the Amorites once on their way through, to a trained, settled, encamped in fortresses enemy, who were trained as soldiers and weaponed and had weapons of war. And God said, "Don't be afraid." He repeats it about 7 times. "Don't be afraid, Joshua. I'm with you. I'll be with you. Don't be afraid. I'll be with you." God seems to think that he being with you makes all the difference. He said to an old man who was older than I am, by 1 year and 1 month. It was Moses. Met him at a burning bush. And he said to Moses, "I want you to go and set my people free, about 3 million of them, slaves. Go down to Pharaoh and tell him to let them go." Moses said, "Who am I?" I'm nothing. "Who am I? What have I got?" God said, as if this would settle every question, "I'll be with you." 5 words. No more question. "No worry, Moses, I'll be with you." Oh, he said that to you too. Jesus said in Matthew 18:20, I think it is, "I'll be with you always." So if he's going to be with you, no more questions, no more troubles. But it's not as simple as that, is it? But if you allow those words to get into you and your believer believes them, "I, the mighty God, will be with you. I have stored everything that you need in the heavenly places, and you can believe and receive what you need." Not once, it's a lifestyle. You just keep doing it. You just keep doing it. Just keep on doing it. Just do it. It's not just something that falls out of the sky. It's your decision, made about 1,000 times. And you keep doing it. And my goodness me, nothing can stand against you. So he said, "Be strong and of good courage." Now, meditation is from the inner person. It's not your natural mind, it's your inner mind. You have two minds, the Bible says. As you think in your heart or your spirit or your inward man, so are you. You also have an outward man mind. So I have two minds. This mind, which is really good when you're driving a car. I'd prefer you to be in your natural mind rather than the spirit if I'm on the road. Eating a feet of steak, use your natural mind. There's a fork, I jab it in, put it in my mouth. It's a very good thing, your natural mind. When Neil is feeling all romantic on a moonlit evening, it's his natural man that'll slip his arm around Nancy and say, "You gorgeous." If he was all spirit, he'd just go straight through her. And there wouldn't be any fun in that. If it was just spirit, he'd think to himself, "Wow, I'd love to give her a kiss," and his head would go straight through hers. God made us natural for this natural world, but he made you a spirit to relate to him. And your spirit is the most powerful part of you, without a doubt. So how do I get this truth so it's in my believer? Well, I take this truth. And he said, meditate in it. What is meditation? I'm talking about biblical meditation. And it's in the meaning of the word to meditate, what I'm going to say. I don't have time to go into it in detail, so you've got to take it what I say. To meditate is to take a truth of God, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Whatsoever things you desire, when you pray, believe, you receive them, and you shall have them. To take a truth of God and turn it around and around inside yourself, and to look at it from every possible angle as if it was a diamond with many facets, and ask yourself this question. This is a good question. You don't want to forget it. What will I be like when this truth is fully worked out in me? What will I be like when Christ in me is filling me? What will my face look like? How will I act? How will I treat people when Christ is fully formed in me? Meditation, you listen to this, allows you to see the end result. And if you go to the end result often enough, you won't want to be where you are now. You'll want to go there. If you have this chair you're sitting on, which is quite comfortable, but if you had that chair in your lounge room, nice chair, but then if somebody bought you an electric recliner and it was soft and your whole body melted into that thing, and you had this plastic chair or this wonderful electric recliner, where, oh Lord, this is something else. And you wouldn't want to quickly go back to that plastic chair, even though it's quite nice. That electric recliner is my chair. But can you see what I'm saying? Meditation sees. And if you're wise, you allow yourself to feel. What will I feel like when the Spirit of Jesus fully fills me? What will I feel like when the negativity is gone from me and I think positive, powerful faith thoughts every day, all day? What will it be like when I see petrol prices soaring? And instead of saying they're ripping me off, which I think they most likely are, I say, my God will supply all my need according to his riches in glory. What would it be like when, if I say, saw the end result of the matter from God's point of view, if I saw truth and myself, truth filling me, filling me, filling me, filling me till there's no room left in me for doubt, and I saw myself laying hands on the sick and they're recovering, and I see it and I see it. Well, what happens if I then do it next week and it doesn't happen? Then I go back to seeing it again and doing it again and seeing it again and doing it again, and the day will come when more will get healed than what don't. I think Robin and I were in Cairns, and we prayed for hundreds of people. And I said to Robin, there had to be about 80% got healed in that weekend, Robin, and I think she said closer to 100% dad. I can only think of two that didn't. But you ebb and flow according to how much you believe. And I too can get tired and not do it as much. I usually get up 2-3 in the morning and sit with God and pray, but I practice all that I'm talking about. I just practice it, me and God sitting together. Oh, friend, if ever you get the joy and the thrill of just being with Him and doing stuff in the Spirit with Him that He's taught, well, for me, taught me how to do over many years. Oh, it's a wonderful way to live. Oh, friend, what does your believer believe? That's your strength. Truth believed transforms you. There is no question. Truth doubted does nothing for you. Truth loses its power. So, meditation, repeated many, many times, sets you free. Have you ever read? Oh, I should stop now, I guess. But our last scripture, Hebrews 10:14. He said, He has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. So He perfected you. Where did He do that? On the cross. The new creation, you. Perfect. You are created in righteousness and true holiness. He said to put that new person on. He's created, so He perfected you forever on the cross. Now you're going through the process of sanctification, separation to God, being made holy. It's a process. But He did it on the cross. So can I now allow to see myself like that? Absolutely. Will that give me a swelled head? No. It'll make me a Christian. I see what God has done. He healed my body on the cross. Am I allowed now then to see myself healed even when I've still got a pain in my hip or something? Absolutely. Do I deny the pain in my hip? No. But I just don't accept it. I accept what He's done for me. And if necessary, I'll take an aspirin for the pain in my hip. But I'm only taking that while I'm waiting. Whatsoever things you desire, when you pray, believe you receive them, present tense, you shall have them, future tense. There could be a gap. Tonight we're going for instant. We just take what we get, but we're going for instant. But if you don't get an instant miracle, you can have a miracle. Day by day, here a little, there a little, line on line, precept on precept. And you'll be whole. So what have we said tonight? We've said that truth believed is incredibly powerful. It will transform anybody from anything to anything, from a drug addict, alcoholic, a gambler, a cruel person, to a spirit-filled God person. It said that in the cross He perfected you forever. Now you're going to go through a process of sanctification. Being made holy, what He's already completed. But God always talks like that. He made the most holy place and then He came back and started where the people are and built the outer court. But He made the most holy place first, if you know biblical typology. If you don't, forget about it. But that's what God always starts where He wants to finish. Then He comes back to where we are and leads us through to His starting point, which is the finishing point. So He saved you. He perfected you forever. Now He says, now we're going to go on a journey. And on the journey, you'll hit a lot of problems, most likely. But they're opportunities. Now I'll discover, oh, there's this bug in me. And once I get over this, I'll be all right. And you get over this and you find another bug. You know, oh, man. And after a while, you get to know, now this seems to be a repetitive factor. I didn't know I had all these bugs in me till I came to Jesus. I'm not saying Christianity is a tough life. It's not. It's tough if you don't believe. But if you believe what He says, if you believe it, that He's created a new creation, you. And He says to you, put it on. Put it on. How do you put it on? Well, I know how I put the shirt on. Put it on. I've got a coat there. I can put the coat on. I can take the coat off. Put off the old me and put on the new me, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. Where did that happen? On the cross. He has perfected forever on the cross. Now we're going to go through a journey. And then that journey, if you walk it with God over and over again, you'll be made whole. And another part of you will be made whole. You'll be a much nicer person to live with. Your wife, your husband will be really glad you went on the journey. They'll be very, very happy. They'll say, that whinging, whining thing is gone that I married. And now I've got somebody who's happy. I have to get used to it. Change. Change. Put on the new you who's transformed. Could we pray? Our Heavenly Father, how shall we escape if we neglect such a great salvation? Oh God, how great you are. And how wonderful you've been to us. That you've made provision for us. And you've told us how to get it. And Lord, I pray that what we shared tonight, that I believe you gave us to share, will drop down inside of people. And the faith in them to say, I'm going to do that. I'm going to reach into the realm of the Spirit and take those things that I desire and bring them down over myself day by day and little by little over a month or two. I'm going to be so different. I'm going to meditate. I'm going to view the truth from every possible angle. And I'm going to ask this wonderful question. What will I be like when this truth is fully worked out in me? God, how great you are. You're just the very best. While our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. Some of you might be where I was in 1959. I went to a Billy Graham crusade. As lost as ever a man could be. I didn't go there to get saved. I went there to talk about cattle prices with my cousin Bill Harper. Most likely the only person that shy bachelor fellow ever asked to go to a meeting. But that night I met Jesus. He became my Savior. And gradually he taught me the ways of God over many years. Tonight, he's not far from you. He's knocking on the door of your heart. And he's saying, will you let me come in? Would you let me take your sin, your failure, your mistakes, your shame, your guilt? And if you will give them to me, let me come into your life, I'll bring my peace and my wholeness to you. And you and I can start the journey of life together. Jesus and you. He's been an exceptionally good friend to me for 50 odd years. And he will be to you. If you say, Clark, I'd like that. I'd like him to come into my life, to forgive my sin, to be my Savior, to let his Spirit live inside of me, to help me. Then while heads are bowed and eyes are closed, except mine will be open, would you slip your hand up and hold it up, please? Just hold it up. You're saying to God, Father, that's what I want. I want you to come into my life tonight. Would you raise your hand? Just slip it up in the air. It's not a difficult thing to do. You're just saying, Lord, I want to come to you. I want you to come into my life to be my Savior. Would you raise your hand? Would you? I'm only going to ask one more time, so you need to do it. Don't let your shyness or anything, just thank you. I see your hand. You can put it down. Others of you, would you just slip your hand up? Why don't you? You know, it was about the last time Billy Graham said, "Will you come?" that I found the courage and the ability to leave my seat and to head to the front. But oh my God, how many times have I been glad that I made that walk? How many, oh friend, come on. Last time I'm asking, if you haven't yet raised your hand, raise it now. Would you do it, please? Would you? Would you? Would you? Would you do it tonight? Come on, friend, you can do it. You can do it tonight. Could we all stand? Lady that raised your hand, and if your friend beside you, husband or whatever it is, if you'd just like to come, but if you didn't raise your hand and you say, "Clark, I just wanted to, but something kept my hand down," I'd like you to come too. Just come and stand the front facing me. I want to pray a very special prayer with you tonight. Would you come just now? Would you come? Just slip on down here, just like I came to a Billy Graham crusade, and come on, that's the way. I'm so proud of you for coming. God's going to meet you tonight. It's going to be the greatest night of your life. Everything that you've ever done wrong will be taken away. Stand beside her, sir. Come. Then we're going to pray together. And the Spirit of God's going to come into your life. And God's going to do a wonderful thing for you tonight. The congregation can be seated right here in the front. Would you say this prayer out loud, saying these words to Jesus? "My Lord Jesus Christ, I ask you to come into my life.
I ask you to come into my life.
To forgive my sin.
To forgive my sin.
And to heal my body.
And to heal my body.
And I ask you to come in now.
I ask you to come in now.
And lady, the Spirit of God is all over you now. And that mighty Spirit of the living God coming into you, settling inside of you. And Father, I rebuke everything that has troubled this woman. I break its power, cast it from her. Right from childhood up, Father, it's lost its grip. And let the anointing of the Spirit of God come all over this very precious woman. She's now your daughter. You're her heavenly Father. Now she has every right to come to the throne of the living God and say, Father, I draw down over me your anointing, your mighty healing power." Amen.